Thank you, Caitlin and Angela.
Amen.
Amen. Good message and song. Thank you for being here tonight, being part of this cross-branded Cowboy Church, Pineville, Louisiana. I say this because of our electronic friends who will be with us, worshiping with us tonight via YouTube. We're located on Highway 28 East, and we're glad that you're here in the room with us, and we're glad for all of those who will be worshiping with us electronically. Turn with me in your Bible, if you will, to the third chapter of Mark's Gospel. We want to begin reading with verse 20. The third chapter, Mark's Gospel, begin reading with verse 20. The theme that's going to claim our thoughts for the next little bit has to do with what it takes to be a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ. And just so we'll know, that's not easy.
Man.
As a matter of fact, down through the years, there's been something of a hardship about that. Please close this door. We appreciate the problem that we have with limited space, and we're getting our plans finalized for the construction of a new building. So don't get your pocketbooks ready. We'll be coming to have more space than this to work with. But following Jesus Christ has never been simple and it's never been easy. You read in other places in the New Testament, for example, there was a day when the Lord Jesus over in John 6, don't turn there, stay with me in Mark 3. But in John 6, the Lord Jesus made the statement that he was the bread of life and nobody could come to the Father except through him. And the Bible says at that point, many of his followers went away and followed him no more. And what they said was, this guy's sayings are just too hard to swallow. Then there was another day when the Lord Jesus was telling a parable. This time we're over in Luke 18. Don't turn there. Stay with me in Mark 3. We're just what we're doing here is building a foundation to take off from. But in Luke 18, the Lord's telling the story of a crooked judge. And there's a little widow lady that goes to him and wants him to render a judgment against somebody who is harassing her. And the law is on her side and she knows it. And the judge knows it. But she doesn't have enough political clout to make it worth his while to render this judgment. So he ignores her. Well, she comes back on Tuesday. And he ignores her. And she comes back on Wednesday. And he ignores her. And she comes back on Thursday. And he said, my goodness alive, if I don't do something for her, she's going to make me look bad in the community. And so he rendered the judgment. And then the Lord Jesus says, as he told this parable many, many years ago, he said that the Heavenly Father is way better than that crooked judge. And when his people cry out to him, they don't have to come back 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 times. He hears them right away and he vindicates his own. Although he does have this one problem, God is long-suffering with sinners.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
And then the Lord added this little phrase, nevertheless, and it's almost like he says, I really wonder, will the Son of Man find any faith left on the earth when he returns? Mm-hmm. Now these two little vectors that we find in the New Testament set us up to read this passage of Scripture about what it takes to be a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ. It is not easy. Never has been. Never has been. Any church that I've ever been a part of had more that quit than those who stayed the course. What does it take to be a follower of the Lord Jesus? Read with me Mark 3, beginning with verse 20. Then the great multitude came together a second time so that they could not so much as even eat bread. And when his own people heard about this, they went out to lay hold on him, for they said, he's out of his mind. the scribes who came down from Jerusalem to do an inspection, they say, he has Beelzebub, that is, by the ruler of demons, he has the power to cast out demons. And so he called them all to himself, and he said to them in parables, how can Satan cast out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. And if a house is divided against itself, that house cannot stand. And if Satan has risen up and is fighting himself, guess what? He's divided and he cannot stand, but has come to an end. No one. Now here's the better way to understand what's going on, Jesus says. No one can enter a strong man's house and plunder his goods unless first he binds the strong man, and then he can plunder his house. Verily I say unto you, all sins will be forgiven the sons of men, and whatever blasphemies they might utter. The word blasphemy means downsizing language. Somebody blasphemes me, they use words that make me look a whole lot smaller and dumber and stupider than I really am. It's a down talking. Somebody said, all the blasphemies they may utter will be forgiven, but whoever blasphemes the Holy Spirit never has forgiveness, but is subject to eternal damnation. Because they were saying, this one, this Jesus, he has an unclean spirit. And then Jesus' brothers and his mother came. And they were standing outside, and they sent to him, and they were calling him. And a multitude was sitting around him, and they said to him, look, your mother and your brothers. This is the first hint we have that Joseph is dead, or he would have been with them. They're outside, and they're looking for you. He answered them and said, who's my mother? Who are my brothers? And he looked around in the circle of those 12 disciples that were sitting around him. And he said, here's my mother. Here's my brothers. For whoever does the will of God, that one is my brother and my sister and my mother. You can feel something of the tension and the difficulty of being a follower of Christ. He wasn't very long into his ministry. We're only in the third chapter of Mark. Mark's got 16 chapters, so we're just a few weeks in, and he's already in trouble with the law. And he's also in trouble with his mother. When your mom gets into it, you're in the soup, let me tell you that. And so you have the Pharisees, they send an inspection team. The way things worked in those days, the Romans collected taxes, and they provided all of the police and the military and the security system, but they allowed the Jewish Sanhedrin to make the rules and make the laws by which people had to live. The Sanhedrin was made up of 70 people, and they were elected from each of the various districts and cities and towns according to population. And they sent an inspection team down. Jesus, you heard the passage say that this is the second time the crowd has gotten together. We're talking a crowd of 8, 9, 10,000 people. They come together again. They're crowding in on them so much so that they could not even have supper, it says in verse 20. They're just absolutely crushed by people wanting to see this guy and wanting to listen to him as he preaches and as he teaches the words of God. And so the Pharisees come and they watch, and he casts out devils. You hear that in chapter 2 of Mark. And you find him exercising a kind of power of God that sets people free. And so these inspectors think, well, there is power here. There is power here. He's doing it. I mean, you can easily tell the difference between some guy who's insane as a Bessie bug one minute and in his right mind the next. And Jesus, his prayer is the thing that made the difference. So what they come up with, they concoct this story. We know he has power, but you better be careful, you crazy people who are following him around, you followers of Christ, y'all better watch out. Here's the thing. He is in league with Beelzebub, who's the prince of demons. He's a lieutenant. And you got a bunch of little devils down here that are but privates. They don't have the authority of the big boy. Jesus is in with the big boy, and that gives him authority over them to order them around and kick them out and do all he wants to do with them. This was their story, and they were going to stick to it. His own brothers and his sisters and his mother, they had another angle on it. They said he's out of his mind. He's out of his gourd, literally. The Greek word is exesteme. Our word existential comes from it. It literally means he has departed from his existence. He's out of his life. He stepped out of himself. He's not home anymore. Have you ever been with somebody like that? You look them in the eye and you think, my goodness alive. You're listening to him talk, you think, there's nobody home. There's nobody home behind those eyes. And so this was what his own mother would think. And she's the one that had talked to an angel, and the angel had told her that she was going to bear a child before she even came together with her husband. This was the miraculous virgin birth mother. And she's confused and doesn't know what's going on with this boy of hers. 30 years old and acting like this, I'll take him down a peg. James, Judas, Joseph, y'all come go with me. We're going to go get him. The Bible says they intended to grab him, to grasp him, to twist his arm up behind his back and say, son, you're coming home. You have lost your marbles. Now, the reason they thought he might have lost his marbles were these crowds he was putting. And the Romans always got nervous when they saw a crowd bigger than their soldiers could control. What if these Jews get behind this guy, and what if they revolt, and what if they break out? We're not going to have that. And they knew that he was about to get in trouble with the Romans. He's already in trouble with the Pharisees. Lost his marbles. We're going to twist his arms up behind his back, and we're going to take him home. Now, let me just suggest to you that if you're going to be a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, you can count on it. You're going to get caught in some confusing situations. There are going to be times when your mama's not going to understand it. There's going to be times when dad's not going to understand it. I can remember when I surrendered to preach, one of my dear, dear friends, she said, are you sure you want to sink that low?
Wow.
I heard the same language a few years later when I was at East Texas Baptist University. We had an older lady whose husband was the superintendent of schools in Marshall, Texas back in those days, 1966-67. And we were sharing a class, and she and I had to work on a group project together, and she looked me straight in the eye and she said, Herb, don't waste your life being a preacher. She said, you can do better than this. Following Christ is confusing. And sometimes it will cause you to have to run against the tide. Sometimes what the Lord asks you to do won't fit in your cultural setting, in the job or in the school or wherever else that you are called on to do your assignment in this world as a professional or as in your everyday life. It can get confusing and it can get dangerous and it can sure get discouraging. Jesus says to his disciples, when all these said, we can't follow him anymore. This is too hard. We're not going to do this. He says to his disciples, are y'all also going to quit me? And I have been pastoring now for 52 years, and there are more quitters than there are stayers among the followers of Christ. Let's just go right ahead and be honest about it. and you're yourself, and you're following Christ. I'm not talking about some problem with a disease, some problem with finances, some problem with a relationship. These things that normally everybody has to deal with sometime or other. But in your following of Christ, somehow, some way, sometime in these next few months, year, or whatever, it's going to get dark and confusing. And you're going to wonder, why am I going to church? What is this all about? I'm not getting ahead in life. I thought if I would go to the church and join the church and become very religious, the good stuff would start happening for me. Mm-hmm. And look what happened. I didn't even get the promotion on my job, and now I got fired. Because I wouldn't go out drinking with the boss and his girlfriend behind his wife's back. Following Christ. Confusing even to his own mother. Now, let's look at the passage of Scripture and see what it takes to be a follower of Christ. The Bible gives us here some hints as you look at the Lord Jesus Christ. And I want to say, first of all, to be a follower of Christ, you're going to have to be a person of great, not average, great common sense. When these Pharisees were questioning Jesus Christ in this passage of Scripture, how did he respond to them? Have you looked at that? How did he respond to it? He used good old common horse sense. He reasoned with his mind, and he pointed out to them that what they were saying was stupid. He said, look at it, guys. Look at it. If Satan is fighting against Satan, who's going to lose? If a house, here's the people in a house, and all of the kids on one side get mad at all the kids on the other side, and they go together and they start hitting one another on the head with sticks, who's going to wind up with bloody heads? He said, you guys can't think straight, or you wouldn't even come up with a goofball story like that about me. He said, if Satan's going to fight against Satan, he will. And I'll tell you right now, he's dumb, but he's not that dumb.
Yeah.
But the Pharisees were that dumb. This inspection team that they sent were that dumb. Let me tell you a little bitty secret about those Pharisees. They were ruled by two motives. One was envy. Here's this guy, he pulls 10,000 in his church, and when we have our service at the synagogue in Capernaum, we only get about 300. Vicki and I have been in that synagogue, and that's about all it'll hold. And the Lord couldn't even come close to that. He had to get out on the side of the lake, on the side of a mountain, where the thousands could gather in it. They were envious, and they were jealous on the one hand, and the second motive that was driving them was fear. He's going to put us out of business. Everybody's going to go join his church. Nobody's going to come to our church. And if nobody comes to our church, there's not going to be any money in the offering plate. And any time you've got jealousy and envy driving your thinking, guess what? Stupid is all that's going to come out. And we can't be followers of Christ with jealousy in our hearts toward anybody, especially another brother or sister in the family of God.
Yeah.
And we can't be fearful of our place at the table of Christ as though somebody else might come along and get our chair. I never will forget when I moved north to South Dakota, ran into that old guy from Lake Wobegon, Mississippi. I'm Minnesota. Not Mississippi. Lord, no, not Mississippi. Remember him? He's always telling stories. Garrison Keeler, yeah. About church. And one of the big problems in the church at Lake Wobegon was everybody in the church had their own seat. They've been sitting in that seat for 40 years, and if anybody else were to come in and get to their seat before them, they'd ask them to move. And one day some visitors were coming by and walked in and sat down in the wrong place. It happened to be the Ferguson's chair, bench. And Mr. and Ms. Ferguson had 9 kids, and they all went over 200 pounds. And it took the whole bench. And here were these two strangers from out of town sitting on the bench. Mr. Ferguson looked at that, sat down, and he began to ooch. And he ooched the visitors down against the wall. And then his crowd got in there, and they sat down, and they were wedged. And it came time to stand for the closing prayer, and nobody could get up. We get so fixed in our place and afraid somebody's going to get our place that we get our feelings hurt and just don't go to church anymore. Following Christ is just too complicated. Well, if our motive is envy and jealousy, let me tell you a secret, you're not going to last long anyway. But there are some people in this room right here now, I'm going to tell you, they got problems. It's a matter of time one of those problems lands right on your big toe. It'll mash your foot, and you're going to have to chip into the gear that the New Testament calls the gear of long suffering and patience. And so, the first thing you're going to have good common sense to understand we can't fight ourselves and do any good. We can't make it ruled by jealousies and envies and unforgiving hearts and souls and minds. Not going to work. Common sense says we can't fight each other and make this thing go. We've got to love each other, care for each other in a way that you don't find in the world where Satan rules. You'll notice that this passage of Scripture is very blatantly honest. There is a kingdom of Satan. And Satan can suck you and me into it if we don't know how to be a good follower of Christ. All right. A second hint that this passage gives us, not only do we have to have good common sense, but we need to have good spirit sense. Good common sense will get you so far and a long way in following Jesus Christ, but there comes a time when the Holy Spirit will speak into the innermost recesses of your soul and say, I want you to go this way, and I want you to do this. And I want you to do this. And he'll even have you, if you listen to him and if you follow the prompting of the Holy Spirit, he'll have you loving your enemy. And he'll have you, as the Good Samaritan, taking care of people who are all beat up, chewed up, chopped up, and can't help themselves. Even if it costs you some money. Good spirit sense is absolutely essential if we're going to be a follower of Christ. And the Pharisees in this passage of Scripture had no clue who the Holy Spirit was. They were looking at the work of the Holy Spirit. People whose lives had been ruled and possessed by the devil had been set free by Jesus Christ. And they looked at that and they said, my goodness, how demonic can it get? And the Lord Jesus says this, whatever you do, don't blaspheme the Holy Spirit and belittle him and treat him like he's some cheap, good-for-nothing little impulse that might somehow actively and accidentally arise in your behavior patterns. Amen. No such thing. He is the presence of God with power. And in every church where I have ever had the privilege to serve, I could look out and see here's one that the Holy Spirit delivered. And here's one that the Holy Spirit salvaged. And here's one, and here's one, and here's one. And I get out on my knees in my study and I say, Lord God, give us another miracle.
Yes.
And you can always spot the miracles of the Holy Spirit of God. They always take one specific form. You know what that form is? Changed life.
Amen.
Takes alcoholics and makes them sober.
Yes.
Take wild, goofy cowboys and turns them into Christian gentlemen. And he takes wild women that dip snuff and turns them into Christian ladies that you won't be ashamed to be seen with. They always told me growing up that I should never, ever. How did the old saying go? You don't smoke or drink or dip snuff or go with girls that do. Remember that old saying? I didn't quite get it out of there right. The Holy Spirit changes people's lives. Do you know how we can be absolute, perfect, sure? Even though the Holy Spirit's invisible, even though God's invisible, and even though Jesus is very visible, but we're just not in the same realm that He's in. We'll see Him one of these days with physical eyes, but we can't right now. But you know how we know they're really, really there? Because they extend the power of heaven into the hearts and minds of men and women and boys and girls who are bent on throwing themselves away. And He turns them and makes something beautiful and good and special out of their life. And there, I can take you to thousands upon thousands of witnesses who will look you in the eye and say, the Holy Spirit did. It wasn't me. It wasn't me. Spirit sins. The second thing is absolutely essential to be a follower of Christ. Common sense, and then third and final. And I know you want me to get through quick because we got good food next door. You're going to have to give priority. And this one's going to hurt. To the family of God above all other family considerations. You hear what Jesus said? His mother signed this note. They couldn't get to him because of the thousands that were gathered around him. His mama, they said they sent him word. Probably a little written note. Jesus, you get out here. This is your mama. Mary, M-A-R-Y. Sent him the note. This is family calling. This is family talking. You know what Jesus did with that note? I can't do that. I gotta have my conclusion. He wadded that thing up and threw it down. He said, listen to me. My family are those who love the will of God and give their hearts and souls to it above all other family considerations.
Amen.
Yes.
In another place, you know what Jesus is going to say? If anybody loves father or mother more than me, he's not worthy of me. Mm-hmm. If anybody loves husband or wife more than me, not worthy of me. If anybody loves child more than me, not worthy of me.
Yeah.
Is it any wonder that they quit following Christ? They couldn't understand it. He got confused. He confused Mary. The Bible says Jesus' brothers didn't trust him or believe in him until he rose from the grave. That's what it took to turn their minds and change them. Now, you want to be a follower of Christ, you just look around you here. Here's your brothers and your sisters. And they are supposed to be closer to you than DNA blood brothers and sisters.
Amen.
You remember when Jesus is hanging on the cross and he's about to die He looks down, he sees his mother, and he also sees the Apostle John. And he says to John, "John, look at her. She's now your mother." He says to his mother Mary, "Look at John. He's now your son." And he was assigning John to take care of his mother because he's the oldest boy and he's fixing to die and be gone off the earth. Well, they have a law in Judaism that the next oldest son's supposed to do that. You know who the next oldest son was? His name is James. He wrote us a book in the New Testament, but he wasn't saved yet. John was saved, and Jesus entrusted his mother to a saved brother rather than to a blood DNA biological brother who wasn't yet saved, because he knew the family of God takes priority over all family considerations.
Yes.
I tell you what will happen. If you can't understand this and you can't follow this, Satan will use some earthly family situation to destroy your following of Christ.
Amen.
It might be a child, a son, or a daughter. It might be a husband. It might be whatever. And many and many one quit following Christ because if they did so, they'd make their husband mad or make their wife mad or make mom and daddy unhappy. I remember witnessing to a boy, and I thought, boy, this is going to go good. In Crockett, Texas, he broke down and started crying, thinking about Jesus dying for his sins. And then we came right down to the moment. I said, "Would you like to be saved?" He said, "No." He said, I can't. I've got to stick with my mother's religion." Well, she didn't have it. I thought, "What? You, please don't do that." He said, "No, I'm not going to go back on my mom. She don't want me joining any church." And be a follower of Christ. Priority's got to be the family of Christ.
Yes. Amen.
Got to have spirit sense. You got to have common sense. You got to be able to understand. We can't fight against ourselves. It just doesn't work. In the following of the Lord Jesus Christ. I said before, more people quit than give up. Did you know that? That's true. The census says there's almost, I don't know, something like in central Louisiana, we claim that our shopping area services 125,000 people. The census says that probably 25% of them are Christians. Let me tell you a secret. On Sunday morning, you're not going to find but about 7% in the Lord's house worshiping them. The others are like those in John 6 or Luke 18, following Christ. Just got too complicated. They gave up and they quit. May God give us grace to understand how to be a follower of Christ and to lock on to the Holy Spirit of God with all the faith we've got. And there's nothing going between us. Bow with me in prayer. Gracious Lord, we thank you for your word. Would you make it now a lamp to our feet, a light to our path, and hide its truth in our heart so that we not wander off and quit. Because following Jesus Christ in this world is no simple, easy thing. Lord, make us spiritually tough. Tough enough to say no. Tough enough to think through and see satanic subterfuges whenever they pop up, either in our family or in our community or on our job or sometimes right in our congregation of worship. Lord Jesus, reach down from heaven, grab hold of us and keep us.
Yes.
In your power. Keep us, Lord, in your will and in your purpose, we pray. In Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.